I think I have another like 2 or 3 minutes I have to wait. But in the meantime, I can tell you like a little bit of like a story if you like. Should I?
Yes.
Okay, who of you knows Fanta, the soft drink? Excellent. Okay, it's a Nazi drink. Why? The backstory is that when the Coca-Cola company, America, like the United States, finally got into like the war with Japan and Germany and Nazi Germany and Nazi Austria, of course, they had the problem that they couldn't, I mean, the federal government didn't want Coca-Cola to have like such close connections, you know, selling stuff to the enemy and blah, 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 blah. But they still had all the bottling plants there, but they were not allowed to ship like the secret ingredient and all that stuff over to Germany. So they had all the bottling plants, but they couldn't make Coke there. Although Hitler liked Coke very much, and actually the Völkische Beobachter, it's like it was the big Nazi newspaper, they had like full page advertisements, like SS soldiers drinking Coke and stuff like that. They really liked it. So they couldn't like make Coke any longer. So they said, perfect, we still have bottling plants, we have still all the infrastructure, just like let's create a new drink and let's call it Fanta. End of story. They are, yes, they are. I'm not used to that. Fail, yes, 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 yes. I can try to blind myself. Yeah. Yeah, I think I have to wait until like this like crazy ass private investigator is over. With, I don't know. Who knows that guy? Yeah, it's all, we're all fucked. It's so horrible. Yeah. Oh yes, yeah, yeah. By the way, who liked the whole WikiLeaks drama? Did you like it? It was like perfect. I mean, I'm from Europe, you know, and I like to come to the States to see good drama, good theater, good performance. Like having like fake guys rushing out and stuff, and the real guy is not actually here, and nobody's really interested in the representative, or maybe, I don't know, but still it was cool. There was this like, it felt good, yeah? Because usually the state is pretty good in security theater, but I think hackers are good drama queens too. I like that, yeah. Yeah. Ah, come on! Of course, come here.
Your iPod is not being here.
Again? Why do they always assign you to me?
This is me. I was stuck in the elevator.
Oh, that's perfect. That's perfect. With a Fed?
So, how would I know? We did a quiz and no one raised their hand. The spot, the Fed thing. Well, maybe. I can smell a lot of things, actually, come Saturday evening. So we have another great talk here from... Oh, you're done? Okay. So I have to tell a story about Austrian Coca-Cola now I have to share with you. I think everyone's clued into the schedule changes for this evening. I think I'll not repeat them now. We're an hour behind, and Robert Steele's going to be over there at midnight, and... Telephone Pioneers is moved back after social engineering. That's the summary. And it's written down on the panel in the back. And we're honored to have the second of two talks here, so let's go.
Yeah, yes, okay. Failing. Okay. Yes. Dear networking class, white collar supremacists, my name is Johannes, and I'm here at Robert. It's a great conference. I really enjoyed so many people, predominantly male. It's really great. That's why I talked about sex yesterday. And today I want to talk to you about who you are and what you think you are. So, first of all, I'm from Austria. That's why I told this nice little story about Nazi Austrian, like Fanta and Coke and stuff. And today I want to talk about reach out and touch face. Okay. I have a graphical representation for that. Yeah. It's a rant about failure. I'm not even sure if I pronounce it correctly, failure, but that's what I want to talk about. So, hackers love knowledge. That's a computer, yes. Hackers love knowledge, and they love showing off with knowledge. They wank around about knowledge. And they try to find out how stuff works, and that's great. That's why we're all hackers. Experimentation is a major part of hacking. Computer culture reflecting computer culture, reflecting culture that is reflecting computer culture, and yeah. So, experimentation is a major part of hacking. And why? Why is that cool? Why are experiments interesting? Well, in the most philosophical sense, it's about deconstructing things. Hackers take stuff apart and rearrange it, and it's really comparable to like wonderful, like almost like post-structuralist like philosophy. A specific use is never inherent to an object, a technological object, although technical demagogues like to claim that it is. I know, there's lots of blood on keyboards. Let's just take the term self-explanatory and take the term archaeological find. And you'll see, I mean, well, that stuff is not all self-explanatory. No, in no way. It's actually pretty hard. It's a pretty hard task to find out what technology is and what it should do if you don't have a clue about the context of technology. So if there is some kind of machine and you just don't know what it should do, who will, what, where, what, yeah. Usually, the use is connected with the object through definition, like the instructions of use. It's like the fucking manual we should read, okay? But what is, if there is no fucking manual, what should we do? Turning an object against the use inscribed in it means probing its possibilities. And indeed, I would like to pound in the nail with a power drill, but at the moment, the fear of freedom and the fear of responsibility predominates. So that's why I'm not using a power drill to hammer in a nail. I use a hammer. But it would be pretty cool to do it. Science and technology studies, especially Langdon Winner, that's this guy here, and Bruno Latour, a Frenchman, have convincingly demonstrated that the widespread inability to understand technological artifacts as fabricated entities, as social and cultural phenomena, derives from the fact that in retrospect, only those technologies that prove functional for a culture and can be integrated into everyday life are left over. All the failures, like, you probably never see them. However, the perception of what is functional, what is successful, what is useful, is itself the product of cultural and social and last but not least political and of course economic processes. Selection processes and abandoned products, like developmental derailments, sobering intermediary results, useless prototypes, all of that crap that's usually not being discussed. So all the millions of failures out there, all the stuff that went wrong, nobody talks about it, but it's an inherent part of technology. So why do I tell you all that crap? Okay, well, I came across a book. It's pretty old. It's from the year 1997. I think I bought it in 1999. Actually, at the Fringewear store in Austin, Texas, if someone knows that. Whatever. So I bought it there, and I read it. There are probably tons of books like this book on the market nowadays, but I'm not wasting any more money on that crap. So I just used this one. It's a little bit old, but whatever. It's called Tales from the Tech Line, and the subtitle is Hilarious, Strange, but True Stories from the Computer Industry's Technical Support Hotlines. So it's pretty old, but in it there are stories about people, for example, who ask in software shops about word for Game Boy. Or, in the meantime, it's actually pretty plausible. But back then, haha, word for Game Boy does not exist. Or people who think that the beta version of their software doesn't work because they have a VHS computer. I like that. Or those who evacuate their house because of the old Apple error message, because they think the computer will explode. Or those who think that the mouse is a foot pedal. Or those who punch holes into diskettes to put them into a binder. Or simply think that the CD-ROM drive is a coffee cup holder. Okay, so now an excerpt from the book to read to you. The tech guy, all right, now I'd like you to quit any programs you're running and close any windows you've got open. Caller, well, okay, there are only two windows here in the basement and they're both already closed. Tech, no. The windows on your screen. Ha ha ha. Okay. So, one might think this is poking fun at others. Well, ha! That probably was the roughly intention of the publishers as well. A few laughs at someone else's expense. And I mean, you kind of know the story. People who don't know shit about JavaScript and whatever. I don't know. There are people out there who like to laugh about people who don't know stuff that they know. So, and that's pretty much a book for those guys. It's a baleful grin for the woefully stupid, taking delight in the ignorance of those not in the know. The smugly esoteric giggle of the congenti. It is a joke collection for the happy winners of the digital two-class society. Get wired or you are toast. Even the field of humor nowadays appears to be trimmed to productivity. But wait. Let's change the reading. They're not stupid, they are Luddites. That's what they are. And if you don't know Luddites, the Luddites of the 19th century, they defended themselves against new machines in the textile industry. It were people who didn't want to, they didn't want it to happen that their personal social status would be taken away from them because they were replaced by machines. So the Luddites of the 19th century, they were fighting against machines and systems who took away their work, their wages, and their social status. And these guys here, the people in this book, the people who don't know that the mouse is not a foot pedal, they are the Luddites of inability. So they are the saving clock in the cocks of the machinery of progress. So you might think I'm stupid myself, but I have to tell you, no. The human factor in the simple-mindedness of the programmers of our future, that's what I'm talking about. Inability. Inability is glorious. Unknowing is a virtually miraculous deceleration, a sneer at the high-speed processes of our capitalist technological world. So, dear people, honorable failures, the clicking of your keyboards is the erosive crank of the man-eating meat grinder that your doing wears out. Your approach, the way you use your computer, makes corporate bosses cry and sublimates capitalism with the procession of grand emotions into top management. You probably don't understand the word. Okay. The information age is an age of permanently getting stuck. All of us. Greater and greater speed is demanded. New software, new hardware, new structures, new cultural techniques, all the time, all of the time, every day. New stuff, and new stuff, and new stuff, and new stuff. Lifelong learning, yes. But the company can't fire the secretary every 6 months just because she can't cope with the new version of Microsoft Word, okay? They can count her keystroke, they can measure her productivity, but they will never, ever be able to sanction her inability. Never, motherfuckers. Because it's imminent. We are all stupid, we are all dumb, we don't know all the time for the rest of our lives. The Peter Principle, you might have heard about that one. The Peter Principle has to be applied to humanity as a whole too. So, what's the Peter Principle? The Peter Principle pretty much says the following. One rises higher and higher in the hierarchy of life. Like a guy working, like, I don't know, in a Waffle House. Now that's a bad... like IBM. Someone works at IBM. Or even better. Someone is working for the US government. No. Military, even better. Military, okay? And it's a lieutenant, okay? And the lieutenant does was what they do like... What does a lieutenant do? I don't know. But the lieutenant does what the lieutenant does. And because he's so good, he climbs up in the hierarchy of life, and suddenly he is, what's after lieutenant? Captain. He's a captain. And suddenly, he cannot climb anymore because he reached his level of inability. He's just too stupid and too incompetent to become a general. That's why, and that's the basic idea of the Peter Principle, in a hierarchical society as we live in the Western world, everywhere there are people who are too incompetent to get the next ladder up in the hierarchy of life. So that's why so many people, especially in offices, are so frustrated because they are just, like, they are on their level of incompetence, and that's pretty much what the Peter Principle tells us, that we're all fucked, okay? One reaches the level of incompetence where one will ultimately perish miserably. Nothing other than the conspiracy of ignorance, both natural and artificially and artfully cultivated, can save us from the last step into a world that we no longer understand because it couldn't care less about us. Endless possibilities of failure await us. These people cannot be laughed at. On the contrary, these stories should be read as a eulogy in honor of dissidents. The staff member who complains about the fragility of the extendable coffee cup holder 24X on his PC is the fevered nightmare of the manual author thinking he has almost reached a didactic breakthrough. And I just don't want to talk about, like, the boss who, like, invested money in the guy who actually failed in explaining people how to use a CD-ROM drive. You know, they're all failing all the time, money, personally, whatever. So it actually would have been better for the boss not to pay a guy to write a manual to explain people what a CD-ROM drive is and not a coffee cup holder. He could just have spent the money on a barbecue with friends and have a good time, because the problem is that we are all stupid all the time, and he has to learn his lesson, okay? Human consciousness cannot be perceived in the interpretation provided for it. His life work, the life work of selling good CD-ROM drives, is now like the life work of a guy who created a coffee cup holder. And he expires in mental derangement, and his company with him. Okay, so it's all kind of obscure, I know. But someone I recently met, he defined a personal spoken sample as his standard arrow sound on his notebook. And I worked with this guy a couple of months in my office in Vienna. And this standard arrow message, and every time he did something wrong, it wasn't like a beep, it was, "Fuck your mother and die! Fuck your mother and die! Fuck your mother and die!" All the time. It was, of course, hardly congenial, certainly irritating, and after a time, just like completely obnoxious, and I hated it, but it reminded me about my life. Every day, this guy did something wrong, and he failed. He was screaming via his computer at his mother, and I was experiencing it all the time. I said, it's almost like a good basis for a religion, I have to say. It's like Scientology material. So, we don't, of course, want to have like fuck your mother and die in our notebooks all the time, but it's good to think about it. So the basic message I have is go forth and make mistakes. Small ones and big ones and nice ones and stupid ones and trivial ones and catastrophic ones. And while we're at it, just like fuck up your spelling. It's really great. Just like don't care about spelling any longer. It's just like just a way to dominate you. Okay. We're all living... Okay. We're all living in a world of mass competition. That's the core value of our Western society. And that's why I want to talk about failing. Just go to, for example, DEF CON in Las Vegas, and you'll see there are many, many 15-year-old people who show off. They show dicks and wank a lot and say, I'm better than you, and I'm better than you, and I do this, and I do that, all the time, yeah? So there is a massive competition going on, especially among hackers. It's all about showing dick. But there's a problem about that, yeah? Some people might not see it's a problem, but I think it's a problem. Okay, through the dark and not so dark millennia of human history, we have organized ourselves in, let's say, cliques, communities, and fucking nations, of course. World events where like deadly pong balls hurtling toward us. I mean, you might think, what, pong balls? Why? That's a strange metaphor. Yes. These groups were pretty much like the paddles of Pong, yeah? And they were trying. The goal was to knock the ball into someone else's court or back or playing Pong. You can pretty much like reduce world history to playing Pong. It's okay, yeah? Like add military might to the whole thing as a means of wealth distribution to an inefficient system which eats surplus wealth to sustain itself, and competition became the fabric of everyday life. The technology necessary for global cooperation did not exist. There was no global society. It was like just like a couple of tribes around who played Pong all the time, and the tribes grew bigger and bigger and bigger, and it became fucking nation states. But then this crazy thing about global communication started. Okay, competition was established as the default way of interacting with the world. In its genteel form, competition meant games where nobody got killed, like gladiators turned to soccer, turned to table tennis. But 1972, computers became advanced enough to simulate competitive games. And Pong was born. Okay. Pong is a trace of our competitive nature. If we don't want the Pong ball to go off the table, we can program the computer to control the paddles better than any human could play Pong. Our desire to play competitive Pong versus other humans through obsolete hand operation is nothing but a vain show of relative one-upmanship. Okay, there is no point to competitive gaming in the computer age. To be clear, we all fail, but technology could save us if we'd let it do, okay? There is enough material wealth for everyone on the planet to have a sturdy home, a steady food supply, if we stop competing and use our global communication and computation capabilities to level the playing field. Let me show you. It's a small computer game we have on our Monochrome homepage. It's called Brave New Pong. How do you play it? Well, you get it. You control the ball and not the paddles. That's the problem we have. We're always thinking of paddles. We have to think about the ball. in the brave new version of Pong that we created, there is no need to try to hit the ball into someone else's court. Just relax, okay? Move the ball wherever you want to, and the computer will make sure it doesn't fall off the table. Is there anything good about competition at all, you might ask? Well, competitive systems such as like evolution and capitalism are terrific at creating unpredictable change very quickly. It's the trial and error system, and it's pretty good in trial and error. If you're looking for a wide variety of output, competitive systems are the best. They are perfect for stuff like that. Not only will the product of such systems tend to improve over time, they'll fill just about any niche available to them. Competition can be a great inspiration to develop skills related to the goal, which is great if inspiration is needed and the skills are useful. In a system like Pong, however, you just wind up getting better at playing Pong. And that's pretty stupid, okay? A competitive system also is great to ensuring that people who are ahead in the game get exactly what they want when they want it. Like, the hawk who uses highly evolved vision to catch its prey, or like first worlders who use their superior buying power to get iPods. Okay, but why is competition an outdated ideal? Although competitive systems produce such good things as humans and Diet Cola, we also wind up with such things as the extinction of woolly mammoth and guided missiles. I really like that one. Deliver in 30 minutes or less, or you get one for free. It's generating alienation, but it's a horribly inefficient way of producing things people truly need. Most energy in a competitive system is spent not in producing a product, but in staying competitive. And that's a waste of resources. In evolution, this manifests in a less than desirable cycle of predator-prey adaptation escalation. Like there's a dinosaur, then there's a bigger dinosaur, and there's no... Where more energies are spent surviving than actually enjoying life. And I tell you, the dinosaurs, they didn't enjoy life. In capitalism, it results the same sort of relationship, except between those with capital value and those without capital value. People who don't have capital value are trapped working for those who do, and their energies are directed towards keeping their team competitive. Bottom line, a waste of resources. In our competitive system, most of our energies are redundant and wasteful. Redundancy is the result of the wasted overhead when multiple people are working on the same problem in different teams. Like a team could be a corporation. Let's say the team Coke and the team Pepsi are both working on the cola problem. But each spends huge amounts of resources battling each other. I mean, they're nearly identical, yeah? What's the big difference between Pepsi and Coke, okay? But there is so much people... What?
One of them tastes good.
What a dichotomy. Still, I mean, there could be struggle about, like, what's the better Coke? No, Coke is better. No, Pepsi. Competition, fuck it. Okay? Even with a supposedly cooperative society, most businesses exist in order to support other businesses. That's a fact. How much would the production of our essential goods decrease if we laid off our accountants and all the people who supply computers to them and all the people who print brochures to the computer salesmen and the people who produce the ink for those brochures and the people who make packaged good for the truckers who drive the materials around and think of the construction workers who build our office towers and the companies that supply raw materials and the miners who dig the shit out of the earth and the manufacturers of processed food because everyone is so involved in being busy that nobody can cook for him or herself. Well, this is all within the same nation-state system we're talking. I mean, I'm not. It's just like, you know, it's. I'm not attacking only capitalism here. I'm just like, that's what we're doing all the time. Not even like in super capitalist societies. This is a very stupid escalation, and we should all share a common goal to be a little bit hippie-ish about the whole thing. In punk, the fact that your opponent keeps hitting the ball at you means you must spend your resources defending your goal instead of using your time for more noble endeavors. So while we're at it, let's get rid of the patent system and advertisement everywhere. That's, by the way, the patent that Michael Jackson had for his moonwalk. Michael Jackson patented the moonwalk, yeah? And yeah, like patents, advertisements, go, 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 go. Because I guess we won't need that stuff any longer if we don't have to be competitive. Most of our jobs are not directly responsible for producing the things we need as a society. So imagine how much manpower could be freed up from work or to do something different than, like, I don't know, like supplying people with brochures. That's why we created Brave New Punk. And evolution and the very rotten capitalist system have brought us to the point where it's possible to propel ourselves out of our current state of affairs. So I'm saying most of the shit that we have around now is there because of this stupid escalation all the time, and because there was the Second World War that gave us duct tape, for example, and all that stuff. Still, it's there. We should use it, but we should use it to do something useful with it. We're intelligent enough now that we don't need the randomness of a competitive evolutionary system. We can program randomness. It's actually pretty easy. The things that used to be competitive games should now be cooperative games or even non-games. I mean, why not? The world is no longer made up of unpredictable systems separated by non-communicable distances. We're getting smaller and smaller and smaller all the time. By using computer models to produce what we want and distribute it fairly, the age-old game of producing for production's sake and like wasting megatons of butter just because we have too much butter, well, that could come to a halt. Humans have tried organizing themselves in more interesting arrangements in the past, but these systems are ultimately run by other humans. In the new world, we'll be able to relax and let certain technologies do the job, because some of the stuff we are like thinking, oh, it will control us in the future, it actually might also help us, who knows. The pong ball will never fall off the table again. That would be a wonderful thing. Doesn't that sound nice? And don't we all fucking hug now? Yeah. Okay, we have to start to forge our own destiny. That's what I'm talking about. Technology is an important part, but people, and you know that, people lack technological knowledge. Of course, I talked about failure, and I think that we all should fail all the time, but so-called everyday people, like these guys here, what do they know about technology? Pretty much nothing. The main problem is that computer technology nowadays is a very unemotional thing. I mean, I never ever cried sitting in front of a computer, except I think my divorce thing. Yeah, but that wasn't related to my computer. Okay, good. So a computer is pretty unemotional. What is he talking about? He's getting all teary and stuff. No. The question is how we can spread information. The internet is a good way to spread information, but it's not the only way. And one of the major... German clip art, I like it. One of the major art forms of the 20th century was the cinema. And I tell you, I cry a lot in the cinema, okay? And if you follow all the discussions about copyright, intellectual property, and movies, it is still a very important form to make money. Lots of money has been invested into making films. And why do people still go to the cinema? They go to the cinema because it's an experience, and it's about emotion. I mean, when I'm watching a YouTube video, I don't know. But Titanic, oh my God, I have to cry like a baby, okay? I don't say that Titanic is a good film. I'm just saying that cinema has an interesting emotional attractor built in it. People just like dump into it and say, oh, I'm digging this. Oh my, it's good. I have to agree. Movie theaters are very exciting places. Movies are great, like Free Willy 2 and Indecent Proposal and Slacker and Grumpy Old Man. That's a really good one. Great. But the best part is like boom, 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 boom. Bolts and fists and flying and crash action. People go to the cinema in order to experience something intense. Explosions, crashes, crying. Something has to go on in the cinema. I postulate now something that's maybe some of you have already realized that. Traditional narrative cinema finds itself in a catch-22 situation nowadays. And the question mark in impact font indicates it's a problem, okay? There's so many stories out there that have to be told. Stories about us, about our life, about our failings, about our world that are not present in the cinema. So, cinema is about to lose its prime source of narrative, having so far lived from physical action that could be filmed. Cinema needs tempo, cinema needs speed, and there's a great guy named Gilles Deleuze, a French philosopher, and he calls it the movement image. The movement image. The movement image of this guy who may rest in peace, he jumped out of a window, needs physical action onto which the camera can be pointed. Yet, the world we live in nowadays, the world of non-cinema, is losing physical action every day. It is a time of abstract, optically not presentable processes in networks and data systems. Computers are often like large and black, but most of the time they look like they're small and beige. Computers are boring if you look at them. I'm not talking about all these like creepy like case monitors and stuff. Ooh. But most of the time computers are beige and small. And they are boring. There's nothing you could actually film. Film a computer, done. The visible aspect of our age, of what we do all the time, pretty much vanishes out of our life. It vanishes out of technology. And this regress of visual displayability is rather daft. Cinema has lived well from it for more than 100 years. It's easy to turn like an attack on Four Alamo or a train robbery into a blockbuster. The same goes for like bank robberies and stuff like that. There's movement, there are things happening, there is action, you can like get hooked to it. But to hack into an ATM is filmed like in 2 minutes, and if you have like a nice iPhone or something, you can cut it in 10 seconds. It's pretty easy. The problem is that all that stuff I told you, like Ford X and I don't know, bank robbery Y, all that stuff, it's outdated. The stuff is not relevant any longer for our lives. Most of the stuff, most of the crimes out there, they are stuff like that. They're ATM crimes. They're credit card crimes. It's the crime in the banking system. It's the crime between the big cities. It's the crime at Wall Street. All the stuff, our lives are somewhere in cyberspace. And it's hard to film cyberspace. It's hard to actually get like an emotional value out of that stuff. Still, we all live in that crap. We all live with it. We have our Facebook accounts and whatever, but where is that stuff? It's not in the cinema. The cinema is pretty much like looking for new stories, but we don't have them because most of the guys who make cinema fail all the time. Fail, 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 fail. The good thing is we can try to help them. Maybe we'll fail too, but my story is, okay, how can we portray, 1992, it was so nice. How can we portray the stories of the new millennium? How can we tell our stories? All these dramas and comedies and crimes and stories of a world between the computers with the computers. Traditional cinema has been trying to avoid this problem for a long, long, long time. In Iran, Errol Flynn, such a handsome guy. What's that? 2001. Eraser, that's it. In Eraser, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger, there is an interesting scene. There is a power cut in, and it's a really important scene. So he needs some kind of a CD-ROM or something like that. And because it would be just too boring that he just like takes the CD-ROM out of his computer and goes away with it, of course, there is a power cut, and you know the software jack doesn't work. So the CD is in the computer, and the evil guys are coming, and he needs to get the CD out. So with, what does Schwarzenegger do? Rip! That's what he does, okay? Because it's too boring to show like getting a CD out. Okay, so that's how cinema and script writers are dealing with technology. They have it like, it's somehow important, so they have a CD, but ripping it out, whatever. No. Schwarzenegger has a second wonderful scene in Eraser. He uses a cell phone all the time. And he talks to the evil guy and blah, 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 and other people. But in the end, just before like the 10-minute showdown that's in the end of the film, of course, he throws the mobile phone away. The mobile phone flies away, and then he... there is it. That's it. That's the mobile phone. It flies, and then 1, 2, 3, bang! Okay, because... The final showdown, of course, in the final showdown of a film, there couldn't be any technology. No. There's only one technology, and it's the one that makes sound that's like boom, okay? The problem is that scriptwriters are focusing on the wrong things. They are focusing on stuff they actually don't understand, most of them. If they try to do that stuff, they fail. I'm looking forward to see the Facebook adaptation of David Fincher that's coming up soon. I'm not sure if he will succeed. Let's see. But you are there. You live in the world of like the beeps and the zeros and ones to have this like stupid binary crap in my talk. You have to have a 0-1 in a hacker talk, I guess, every time you give one. So the problem is we need better examples for our life, not these like dramatic cramps I showed you. I mean, there's Banderas and Stallone in Assassin, such an awful film. And what do? They fight each other. And because it's too boring just to fight and there has to be something contemporary in it, they take notebooks and they slam each other with notebooks. What the fuck? No! And there's Mission Impossible. I don't even talk about Mission Impossible. Bah! There are tons of examples, but there are hardly any examples that work and that portray our everyday life in the way it really is. So, to be nothing, don't carry it any longer. That's a quote from The International, the song. It's like, you know, communist. Okay, so Schwarzenegger and the guy, like this guy. Well, I forgot his name. Thanks. No, I failed in bringing the joke. Like, of course I know, but then you help. Whatever. Fail. So Schwarzenegger and this guy, they are damned, pretty much. They are as damned as the working class they are singing about in The International. They are damned because the world changed, and Schwarzenegger and this guy, and all the people who consider themselves the working class any longer, they are a community of solidarity. They're a community of solidarity because the very same deindustrialization, it's so funny, the same deindustrialization processes, the same technology which has erased the American working class and outsourced it to China and stuff, the same processes now takes employment away from Schwarzenegger and all the other guys. Because in a couple of years, Schwarzenegger will not be playing any longer, even if he could, because he would just be rendered. He will not be there any longer. The same machines and units which have taken over from industrial workers are the same machines and the same processes and the same progress that now makes like every action cinema hero look so very boring and so very outdated. every action hero is pretty much the last one, or could be the last one, but there's no one to take over. So where are the new stories? And I think you should try. Even if you fail, fail, but do it. Sit down. You're people who know what you're doing. Take a piece of paper and start writing a movie script. And start sending your message out to people who in no other way would probably know about what you're doing. So the cinema is a powerful tool. And there are actually people out there who make like non-budget DIY cinema about whatever. You could even like do your own film. You can do it. I'm not actually only talking about scripts. Just do it. Just try to spread the word that the world actually has changed and some people haven't realized it yet. So it's ironic that all these spectacular scenes in movies are pretty much like the same digital tricks that like will, to a certain extent, make cinema obsolete if we don't change it. Bert Brecht, nice German guy, and he wrote in the 1920s that a picture of a Krupps plant would not show how Krupps as a company or corporation functions and works. Well, back then you could actually point the camera on machines and people sweating, working at the machines and manual laborers. If somebody wants to film the workstation of our service-oriented society in the year 2010, it has to show people on computers, and that's not really entertaining. There's nothing going on, but there's a lot of going on behind the scenes. The system itself is relevant. The mechanisms behind it actually avoid displayability. That's pretty bad, but I think we can help it. I don't know how, that's why I'm talking to you, because I think we can do it together. It's such a nice future out there with unicorns and stuff. We should try to do it. So as a last thing of my talk, maybe we could focus on one common goal. I have a slogan here. You can try to read it with me. I hope you will, okay? Let's try it. Let's try it like synchronous, okay? I want a general recognition of the vanishing of the visible and a disengagement from the anachronistic, from cinema, which has been outdated by technology. Oh, nice. Yeah. So this was my 3-step program about failing, and now it's your turn to fail. But before I let you fail, I want to fail, and you can help me failing it because I try to sing now. Okay? There is a nice Austrian song from the 1970s. It's called "Good Old Hollywood is Dying." Okay? And now, because good old Hollywood is dying, we have to do it in a musical form. So I will project the lyrics and you try to sing with me. So please turn the volume up. I'm starting right now. No, we have not plugged it in. 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 Where is it? There it is. God damn it. What are you doing here? I can...
You needed help. I magically appeared. Oh, get.
Okay, one more time. And you're here, you sing with me, okay?
Okay.
Come here.
All right.
Okay.
Did you ever see a movie where Adolf Flynn played Robin Hood, where Gary Cooper played a hero, and Wretched man's fame was all loot. Did you ever see a movie where Shirley Temple played a child? Where Rock Hudson played a lover? Rutchum's Dean got really wild. Good old Hollywood is dying. Good old Hollywood is crying. Good old Hollywood is Did you ever see a movie watching Kelly dance so bright? Fred Shitty Garland sang a love song where Humphrey Bogart lost a fight. Hollywood is dying. Good old Hollywood is crying. Good old Hollywood is dead.
Huge round of applause for Johannes. Why was I paged up here? No, seriously. Nobody knows? Was that you?
It's the title of the talk.
Fail?
No.
Reach out and touch face.
So can I do that to you too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I ate a burrito or something. Wow.
Big round of applause for Johannes. Thank you.
Good part is always the singing. First, all this like theoretical, like bullshit, and then they're singing. That's always good. Yeah.
Do I have to leave?
Yeah, you do. Actually, have to leave because
I have 10 minutes, but I failed
no,
to take them.
No, because this is over.
Yes, dear networking class, white collar supremacists. My name is Johannes, and I'm here at Robert. It's a great conference. I really enjoyed so many people, predominantly male. It's really great. That's why I talked about sex yesterday. And today, I want to talk to you about who you are and what you think you are. So, first of all, I'm from Austria. That's why I told this nice little story about Nazi Austrian, like Fanta and Coke and stuff. And today, I want to talk about reach out and touch face. Okay. I have a graphical representation for that. Yeah. It's a rant about failure. I'm not even sure if I pronounce it correctly, failure, but that's what I want to talk about. So, hackers love knowledge. It's a computer, yes. Hackers love knowledge, and they love showing off with knowledge. They wank around about knowledge. And they try to find out how stuff works, and that's great. That's why we're all hackers. Experimentation is a major part of hacking. Computer culture reflecting computer culture. Reflecting culture that is reflecting computer culture. And yeah. So, experimentation is a major part of hacking. And why? Why is that cool? Why are experiments interesting? Well, in the most philosophical sense, it's about deconstructing things. Hackers take stuff apart and rearrange it, and it's really comparable to like wonderful, like almost like post-structuralist like philosophy. A specific use is never inherent to an object, a technological object, although technical demagogues like to claim that it is. Yeah, I know, there's lots of blood on keyboards. Let's just take the term self-explanatory and take the term archaeological find. And you'll see, I mean, well, that stuff is not all self-explanatory. No, in no way. It's actually pretty hard. It's a pretty hard task to find out what technology is. State is pretty good in security theater, but I think hackers are good drama queens too. I like that, yeah. Yeah. Ah, come on, of course, come here.
Your iPod is not being here.
You, again, why do they always assign you to me?
This is me, I was stuck in the elevator.
Oh, that's perfect. With a Fed?
So, how would I know? we did a quiz and no one raised their hand. The Fed thing. Well, maybe. I can smell a lot of things, actually, come Saturday evening. So we have another great talk here from... Oh, you're done? Okay. So I have to tell a story about Austrian Coca-Cola now. I have to share with you. I think everyone's clued into the schedule changes for this evening. I think I'll not repeat them now. We're an hour behind, and Robert Steele's going to be over there at midnight, and... Telephone Pioneers is moved back after social engineering. That's the summary. And it's written down on the panel in the back. And we're honored to have the second of two talks here, so let's go.
Yeah, yes, okay. Failing. Okay. End of story.
Are there any of those advertisements online?
They are. I'm not... used to that. Fail. Yes. I can try to blind myself. Yeah, I think I have to wait until this crazy ass private investigator is over. With I don't know. Who knows that guy? Yeah, we're all fucked. It's so horrible. Yeah. By the way, who liked the whole WikiLeaks drama? Did you like it? It was like perfect. I mean, I'm from Europe, you know, and I like to come to the States to see good drama, good theater, good performance. Like having like fake guys rushing out and stuff, and the real guy is not actually here, and nobody's really interested in the representative, or maybe, I don't know, but still it was cool. There was this like, it felt good, yeah? Because usually I think I have another like 2 or 3 minutes, I have to wait. But in the meantime, I can tell you like a little bit of a story if you like. Should I?
Yes.
Okay, who of you knows Fanta, the soft drink? Excellent. Okay, it's a Nazi drink. Why? The backstory is that when the Coca-Cola company, America, like the United States, finally got into like the war with Japan and Germany, and Nazi Germany and Nazi Austria, of course, they had the problem that they couldn't, I mean, the federal government didn't want Coca-Cola to have like such close connections, you know, selling stuff to the enemy and blah, 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 blah. But they still had all the bottling plants there, but they were not allowed to ship like the secret ingredient and all that stuff over to Germany. So they had all the bottling plants, but they couldn't make Coke there. Although Hitler liked Coke very much, and actually the Völkische Beobachter, it was the big Nazi newspaper, they had like full page advertisements, like SS, soldiers drinking Coke and stuff like that. They really liked it. So they couldn't like make Coke any longer. So they said, perfect. We still have bottling plants. We have still all the infrastructure. Just like, let's create a new drink and let's call it Fanta.